Right. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Seat Story Cup 4, Day 2. We're on the Beast Room here. I'm joined by Ika. How are you doing, buddy?
That's me. Yeah, I'm doing just fine. I had a lot of fun so far at Seat Story Cup, despite going 0-6 on the first day. But, yeah, of course, I mean, this is just establishing my negative track record at those tournaments. At least I'm having a lot of fun, as always.
I saw your tweet, man. I felt so bad about it, because you were, like, so hyped for the tournament.
Yeah.
And I was like hoping, not because you're a German and like a cool dude, but like I was just hoping for you because you're one of those people who like really wanted to win.
Yeah, it's like the counter to DreamHack. Like at DreamHack, I'm always performing well, but here, not so much. Maybe next time, who knows?
Is it maybe like too? Is the atmosphere like maybe too casual?
Not really, but I don't know. Maybe it's just bad luck.
I guess it's Hearthstone after all, right? So yeah. I guess that's always a factor. All right, we have Ignite versus Hoi here. In the losers match of this group.
I'm really excited for this match, actually. And it's losers match, so their tournament life is on the line right
exactly,
now.
Exactly, yeah. So loser goes out, and the winner gets to face Ryzen for the chance to stay in this and move on to tomorrow's round of 16.
Yeah, both those players are actually well known in the pro scene. Hoi a little bit more successful than Ignite. Of course, Hoi on the powerhouse team Navi,
yeah.
With his teammates Xixo and the current world champion Ostkaka. Both of which are like at the top 10 of GoTo Gamers ranks. I mean, this is going to be definitely a must-see spectacle.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, as you said, they're in the top 10, which is like so impressive, right? Like if all of your
all
players
three
are
of them.
Yeah, it's like crazy.
By far the strongest team in the Hearthstone scene right now. And we'll have to see if Hoi can actually carry Navi. Okay, although Ostkaka also qualified, but Xixo is out right now.
Yeah, that was like super harsh.
And their testing partner Surrender is also out, so like he's kind of on Navi as well, but
yeah.
not quite.
People didn't expect that, right? To like, I mean, would you have like banked on Xixo and Surrender going out in the round of 32? I wouldn't have.
No, definitely not. I mean, then again, I wouldn't have banked on myself getting out of getting wrecked in the round of 32. But yeah, let's jump right into the game. We see Ignite opening up with his Rogue and Hoi with a Secret Paladin.
Yeah. Hand looking pretty good for Hoi at this point.
Yeah, in theory, the Rogue should be favored in this matchup. However, it all comes down to how well the Rogue can clear the board. Sure, Rogue has many board clears at its disposal with big blade flurries and fan of knives. However, if Hoi can set up a pretty resilient board and just obviously curve out well, like Paladin wants to do, from 1 to 7 or 8, and then Paladin is in a good spot. And also, let's say Hoi plays stuff like Divine Favor as well. It's good. I mean, very aggressive Secret Paladin lists still run that. Mm. And against a class that draws a lot of cards, like Rogue, for example, does, Divine Favor could be a really big threat. But we will see actually what kind of list Hoi runs.
Yeah.
I'm not quite sure. I haven't seen all the matches so far.
This is
the first time I'm actually casting today.
Wow. So he's valuing the Backstab over the Eviscerate. So this is like weird to me for two reasons. First off, like just the value of the card seems perplexed to me. And secondly, he can't really dagger with this. What do you think?
Well, the thing with the Eviscerate is, what does the Paladin really have that is four health that is worth eviscerating? Then again, I mean, he might just use the Eviscerate like Warriors would use a Slam, for example, just to deal two damage. He saves the Backstab then, so he can go for like a Violet Teacher and then Backstab and deal with another small minion for free instead of paying two mana. So that's pretty good. And of course, he could have used the Eviscerate along with the Preparation, which is also pretty sick when you have a Violet Teacher on the board. But we see here the Sprint is obviously a very good combination with Preparation, so that's what you want to keep the prep for.
Yeah, for sure. So yeah, he's going to probably Backstab next turn, kind of hoping for no Avenge to come out here. And I mean, there's an Avenge in hand here for Hoi, but he's like, do you want a muster here, or are you like super scared of some sort of AoE with like a fan or a blade flurry?
Well, you can just drop the muster because it represents a lot of damage along with the juggler, so it's already worth the three damage that it would have dealt with the 1/1s anyway if the 1/1s get cleared. So I would definitely go for the muster here. It's also like a good way to check if your opponent even has AoE.
Yeah.
And then if you know he doesn't have fan in that situation or Blade Flurry, then you can overextend to the maximum.
Oh, there's the fan pickup. Not going to help too much this turn.
Yeah, that would have been really good for Ignite if Hoi went for the muster there.
Yeah.
Violet Teacher into prep fan, and then basically clear the whole board, getting two 1/1s himself.
That'd be sick. All right.
Maybe Hoi was expecting something like that.
Yeah, so. Maybe. I mean, do you just like Vile Teacher backstab at this point, or? I mean, you pretty much know that's an Avenge, right? Or you think it is at least. Like, it seems like it's either Avenge or like Redemption, right?
Yeah. Well, if it's Redemption, then it's pretty easy clear. But Ignite might be afraid of the Avenge, which is actually on the board right now.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens here.
It's gonna go for it.
I suppose it's not that big of a deal if an Avenge hits on the Haunted Creeper, because the Haunted Creeper by itself will not be able to deal with the Vile Teacher still.
Uh huh.
So it's not that devastating. Would have been pretty good if Ignite had a sap in this situation, though.
Yeah.
Just grab out the sap. Complete board domination right there.
So, like, Muster still looks weird if you're scared of a fan. And he did pick up a Shredder. The only good thing about the Muster is that you do get to get that juicy kill on the Violet Teacher. So do you want to go for it?
Hmm.
Or is there also, like, room for a silence, maybe? I mean,
generally, Paladin only wants one, like one consecration. So you kind of want to clear the Violet Teacher early. You don't really want to ignore it because you have a hard time dealing with all those 1/1s. And I think this is what Hoi recognizes and wants to clear it immediately. The silence is sure. The silence is pretty valuable too, but then again, it's just puts a weaker minion on the board instead of like those 3/1s. You have a 2/1 and the 1/1 from the hero power or the mini bot, I suppose.
Wow, the pickup here.
And also the owl can hit like a piloted shredder maybe, which is an even more valuable target.
That's very true, yeah. So prep fan gonna come out of this Violet Teacher top deck. It's pretty nice.
Yeah, that Violet Teacher, that was crucial off the top. That is certainly not what Hoi wanted to see in the situation.
Not at all. And even as a Drake to fill like turn 6 before he can sprint, for example. So yeah, he like desperately needs to regain board control at this point.
Yeah, there is a Shredder, which is a pretty resilient minion. However, we see that Ignite has the means of dealing with it on the board already. So, it will be pretty hard for Hoi to establish some sort of board presence against the Rogue right now, which is the reason why Rogue is favored in general.
Uh-huh.
Like, Rogue has such easy ways, especially if you consider the hero powers, right? The 1-2 weapon already deals with 2 hero powers from the Paladin. It's just inherently better.
Yeah.
I mean, more valuable. The Rogue needs to use less mana than the Paladin to stay even.
He's so scared of this Vile Teacher with the super defensive play here. I mean, it's not bad by any means.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't necessarily say he's scared, but I mean, what else is he going to do, really? He could put down the Pile the Treader, but it just dies to whatever's on the board already.
Uh-huh.
So he might as well just prevent that. The Ignite gets additional 1/1s.
So, I mean, he's going to go for the clear here, obviously. And then next turn he has the Assassin's Blade and the Deadly Poison on that. So that's one hell of a weapon.
Yeah.
It's going to get crazy value.
The drawback, of course, from Assassin's Blade is that it's a fairly slow card. So, and you also obviously want to go phase with it because it's your main source of damage output against some decks.
Exactly.
But yeah, in the meantime, the opponent can punish you by just putting a lot of minions on the board and just smashing your face because you didn't. Assassin's Blade obviously doesn't put any pressure on the board to deal with minions, except if you have like a Blade Flurry, of course.
Yeah. So he is in a position, though, where he can, like, allow himself to do that, I guess, right? Because he's, like, not behind.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Ignite has a lot of health here. The board is fairly clear. So definitely Assassin's Blade into Deadly Poison and just hoping to finish off the game in 3 turns. That could be a good game plan.
Yeah, we'll see. You did draw a fan. It's a spell power fan.
Yeah. I mean, if Ignite faces down a lot of pressure after that Assassin's Blade has been played, there's still a Blade Flurry in his hand. So
yeah.
If in case he needs it, he can reset the board.
Exactly. And, I mean, against Secrets Paladin, very rarely do you see any sort of heal. I mean, even the Sludge Belcher is kind of weird, unless it's like a mid-range version, right?
Mm.
So, yeah. Oh, he's actually going to Flurry this? Oh, no, he wants a fan.
He's just going to clear the Shredder first, see what pops out of it.
It's okay, I guess. I mean, it's not a great clear on the Flame Tongue, but you don't take any damage from it either.
Ignite, basically, by doing this play, he wanted to preserve his board. Like the 4-4 Drake with spell damage and the 3-3 Valor Teacher, they are obviously pretty good bodies and mm-hmm. apply a lot of pressure themselves already.
All right. There's so the challenger.
Yeah, Mysterious Challenger comes down. 4 secrets are dropped on the board.
Double Flurry in hand.
Yeah.
It's kind of awkward with the weapon only having one charge.
He could theoretically clear the board.
Uh-huh.
I mean, there's going to be like Noble Sacrifice. Avenge will proc on the Mysterious Challenger. Mysterious Challenger will go up to 8 HP. Blade Flurry deals 4 damage along with the Azure Drake that deals another 4 damage.
Mm-hmm.
All he has to do is attack with the Violet Teacher first to proc the Noble Sacrifice, obviously.
Alright, there's a sack.
And then, yeah, Redemption will trigger on the Noble Sacrifice. So once he plays Blade Flurry, both those minions will die.
Do you think he'll go for like the super defensive? Like, I'm not going to call that super defensive, but I mean, there's obviously a play where you go face as well, but like, do you want to go for that play instead of flurrying? Probably not, so. I mean, he's going to flurry. Do you think he's going to trade afterwards?
Yeah, of course. I mean, okay. With the competitive spirit that's most likely going to be there on Hoist's side, that Mysterious Challenger would represent 10 damage to the face, and like all 2 attacks from that Mysterious Challenger represents lethal.
Yeah, you can't take that. So the next challenger actually gets top decked here. Yeah. I mean, obviously the second challenger doesn't have as much value as the first one, but still pretty good. Just as a body as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's another Noble Sacrifice and another Avenge, I would assume.
Yeah, 2 more secrets.
Actually, Avenge has been... second Avenge was on the board already. So that's something else. That's Redemption, I suppose. So Noble Sacrifice and another Redemption.
It takes more value out of the Assassin's Blade, actually, because of like another Noble Sack that you're afraid of. You can't do damage to face at this point. Like, how, right? Like, you kind of need to deal with this. Portugal fans in the chat. Chat's, like, hating because you didn't say hi yet.
Oh, I'm sorry, chat. Hi, chat. Please don't spam dance game, okay?
Yeah, please don't.
I'm doing my best here to entertain you guys. Anyway, so we see Ignite going finally going for that Assassin's Blade. Seems to... he seems to be attempting a race right now. Interesting that he decided to not trigger the Noble Sacrifice with the weapon, though.
Oh, wait, what?
Yeah, attacking first is probably the right move.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, well, okay, I suppose, yeah, this is actually, yeah, if he wanted to go for the board clear, this was actually the right attack.
Is it the winning play, though?
Well, Ignite doesn't have to do anything to win right now or in like 2 turns.
Mm-hmm.
All he has to do is control the board. He has the sprint to refill his hand, obviously. So in Ignite's mind, he still has plenty of time. A lot of big threats have been used up by Hoi already. Like there's the 2 mysterious challengers are gone already. Now all Hoi has left is like a Dr. Boom and a Tyrion.
That's true. So as Hoi, you have to dump your hand basically, right? Like accept the blessing, right? I mean, are you still afraid of AoE? Not really, right? I mean, you can't allow yourself
to
be.
Yeah, a preemptive Blessing of Kings is kind of risky, considering that Ignite hasn't played a Sap yet.
Yeah.
And Sap is a realistic possibility right now.
Okay.
So now we'll have to see what Ignite decides to do here.
I mean,
sprinting first seems decent. And there's a Sap, which is pretty decent against a Sludge Belcher. And a backstep, too.
Huh. This actually opens a lot of lines, because he actually has a Thalnos with that backstep as well if he wanted to, but I don't think you go for it, right?
Like, just you definitely want to sap that, because it's, as well, because it's, not only because it's a taunt, also because it's, like, a clunky card.
Uh-huh.
That the Paladin has to use a lot of resources for. Backstep for the Secret Keeper, just to keep the board a little bit more clear. The dagger will clear the 1-1.
Yeah, he wants nothing to get hit by this competitive spirit.
Yeah, and this actually represents lethal next turn.
That double.
The Belcher, of course, Hoi will hope that the Belcher will be enough to stop the Rogue's low step right there. However, we see a second step in Ignite's hand, and that will represent lethal.
Yeah, it's going to be it. I mean, it's so bad for Hoi because you know you can't do anything, right? It's like, okay, if he has sap, it's over. Like, you can't do anything. Kind of brutal.
Yeah, I mean, take a look at how many cards Ignite has left in his deck, please.
Let's see. Ignite has 10.
Yeah, so, yeah. I mean, Hoi might think...
10 for both.
Hoi might think, yes, he still has a shot. There might not be a Zap, but... Yeah, with only 10 cards remaining, with 20 cards drawn, it's quite all right to have two Zaps.
Yeah, I guess. It just looked weird because you got him, like, one sprint, right? But it does make sense statistically. So there's a Belcher. At least Froden won.
Yeah, Froden has been performing pretty well, unexpectedly, right?
Yeah.
He himself didn't expect to perform that well in this tournament. And we see he 3-0 ties.
Did you know how the second game went for him? He won the second game as well?
Yeah, he 2-0'd his group.
No way. What? Jesus Christ, man. Frickin' Froden.
PogChamp.
PogChamp indeed.
And yeah, Ignite, of course, as we said before, takes the series after the second step on the Belcher. Pretty easy stuff.
Pretty easy stuff.
Rogue was expected to win there. Sure, Paladin can, of course, potentially win against every deck just because it's such a powerful deck.
Yeah.
But, yeah, Ignite showing why Rogue is favored right there.
Showing why Rogue's boss. Actually, not a lot of players opting to choose Rogue, but, I mean, obviously this is a different format than, like, Conquest, but, like, Oskaka bringing that to BlizzCon, for example. Like, what do you think of Rogue as a class, just in terms of its matchups? Like, do you think it's viable again, or...?
Oh, for sure. I mean, Rogue definitely has a solid game plan. It is one of those combo decks that has been around for quite a while, which like always has this strategy to just finish the game in like two or three chunks of damage with big Blade Flurry combos to clear the board in the meantime while dealing damage as well. And it's pretty good against many classes, actually, like against Paladin, which is very popular. It's pretty good. It's good against... it's good against Warlocks, and it's good against Priests, for example. So if you're like expecting those kind of decks, then Rogue is pretty good.
Yeah, a lot of good matchups there, and that's a pretty nice hand, actually, for Hoi. As the Druid, which he does pick, Ignite obviously staying on that Rogue. Even an Innervate here. So I talked to a lot of players about this. And if you have like something you can coin out or even a Wild Growth afterwards, people have told me you always Innervate the Shade. Do you agree with that?
Oh, yeah. I suppose it's fine. Yeah, I suppose it's fine. Especially against the Rogue. You want to get out the Shade early because Rogue has, as we know, AoE. Big AoE clear like Blade Flurries. Would be able to clear the Shade very easily.
Mm-hmm.
So the earlier you drop it, the higher the chance of the Shade surviving any kind of AoE from the Rogue. So the Shade can just grow and grow and grow until he deals a lot of damage with the Force of Nature Savage Rock combo.
So how threatened of this Shade are you? Because, I mean, you don't want to flurry it down, right?
No, definitely not. Ignite actually, playing the Fan of Knives here, not only to cycle through, but also to damage the Shade. We see that the Deadly Poison plus Blade Flurry can clear the Shade. And optimally for Ignite, Hoi would play a Piloted Shredder here or something, so he could like Deadly Poison, attack the Shredder, and then clear the board, the remainder of the board with the Blade Flurry.
Yeah, but sadly he doesn't have any play on turn 4. And just playing the Vile Teacher. That's
a
4 drop.
Using a Blade Flurry just for the Shade seems like kind of a waste. You don't put anything on the board at the same time. But this, however, will allow the Shade to grow further and further, and like this Shade will pretty easily get out of range. However, although actually not quite yet. Ignite has double Deadly Poison.
It's still pretty crazy, right? Like this Belcher top deck is like pretty good because it just like kind of stops your opponent from having any other choice than doing that.
Oh yeah, the Shade actually getting out of hiding. I mean, it's fine because the teacher has been cleared and the teacher has been cleared fairly easily. It's always nice to trade a 3-drop up against a 4-drop.
That's true. So the reason like the Belcher was so good is not only does it protect the Shade and represent a 5-drop, but it also gives you something to transition into that coin Ancient Allure next turn. So, I mean, Ignite kind of in a puddle here because not only do you have to clear this, but you also have to get something on the board or at least get something that can remove stuff easily. So we do have double Deadly Poison Blade Flurry at some point. Do you think that'll get played next turn no matter what? Wow, even another Blade Flurry.
Oh, this is a little bit of missequencing right there, although ultimately it doesn't really matter. Mm-hmm. Like, you could have attacked up the Belcher first, so the ooze that spawns out of the Belcher or the slime would get one damage instead of the Belcher from the Fan of Knives. But it doesn't matter that much unless Ignite draws another Fan of Knives.
Okay. So Ancient Lord does get coin.
Although actually you can't draw a third Fan of Knives. You already used like two. So yeah, it doesn't matter at all.
There's Thorson getting picked up as well as a Savage War. So, no, okay. I was about to say, too bad you can't Azure Drake and Flurry with that, but he does have an Eviscerate here.
Yeah, this is actually an interesting turn because both possible plays are pretty awkward. Like, you could Azure Drake just to get a minion on the board, a good minion on the board, and cycle through, but you cannot use a Blade Flurry or Eviscerate along with that.
What do you think of, like...
On the other hand, you could play Bloodmage Thalnos and Eviscerate that Ancient of Lore.
But then your Blade Flurry is weird for the couple of turns afterwards, right? What do you think of just playing the Azure Drake and passing?
This is fine.
Yeah, okay, he's doing it.
But right. Yeah, Hoi, of course, will have absolutely no problems dealing with that Azure Drake.
Yeah.
He has plenty of ways to do it. He could attack it with the Ancient of Lore. He can, of course, swipe it. He could use Wrath plus attack with the slime. But then he kind of wants to have the slime on the board to protect his bigger minions from that potential attack from the 5-1 weapon. So I would actually think that he's going for the Thorson. So he's going to establish a big Thorson, getting a lot of cards cheaper, most importantly the Force of Nature Savage Roar.
Exactly. But he is gonna get he's gonna get memed by the Blade Flurry. Do you like the Wow, I think this is a little fast. Don't you? Like, what do you think of a Thalnos Blade Flurry Van Cleef?
That is certainly an option. It represents more damage on the board, for sure. Ignite, it's definitely a stronger play, I would say.
It's also
but
against BGH.
It backfires if Hoi has like a Keeper of the Grove.
That's true.
Which we haven't seen yet.
Oh yeah, we haven't seen one.
So as a Drake... might be a little bit safer, I want to say, but we will see. Also, Van Cleef might as well just... Ignite might as well just want to save the Van Cleef to get a really big Van Cleef. Not, in complete disregard to BGH. But it seems like he's going to go for it right now, which is fine. I mean, it puts a really good minion on the board. A way better minion than Azure Drake would represent.
That's true. Plus, he still has, like, a spell power minion on board, so this kind of forces him to deal with that as well. I mean, it's only like 2 mana in theory for like a hero power if he doesn't have this wipe, but I like this play a lot more. Yeah. I mean, there's still like 7 points of health that you need to deal with. So how do you do this?
Ignite also has to consider what cards have been made cheaper by the Emperor Thorison, right?
Yeah.
Like right now, usually all the maximum amount of burst you can expect out of the Druid's hand with an empty board is like Force of Nature Savage Roar, right? It's 14 damage. But if depending on how many cards got cheaper, we can add more damage to that.
Yeah,
either
exactly.
By using another Savage Roar or by using something like a swipe. But
he's
Ignite,
choosing
Ignite. We'll have to see how he wants to value his health total. From this point onward,
he's actually choosing the play that gets him the most tempo, right? The most board control. And this Shredder's not going to die completely, basically, unless you like double eviscerate it, right? So probably not going to happen. And there is still that reduced combo in hand here for Hoi, meaning that if he does get his opponent low enough, he's going to die to that. That's 15 points of damage at least from the hand of Hoi. He's going for the eviscerate. Okay, so he's going to take care of this full-on Shredder, but not without taking damage unless something bad pops out.
Yeah, he's going for the board control centric approach, which I like. But he can only do this for he can't do this forever unless he draws into healing.
Problem is, like, if he clears this, which he's thinking about a long time. Like, let's say he clears this, right? Then just like a charged Druid of the Claw hero power brings you to 15.
Yeah.
And that's scary.
Oh, he's going to decide to go for the face with that weapon, it seems.
Oh, interesting.
Leaving that two drop on the board, because he knows he will just be able to clear it with the Blade Flurry the following turn.
He picks up a Shredder with this. So, like, charging the Druid of the Claw, maybe, like, do you want to play Shredder with that, or is, like, that one damage from Hero Power worth more to you?
Well, the Shredder is a resilient minion, so it's kind of obvious right now that Ignite will have some sort of way to deal with that 3-2 on the following turn, like an SI7 or a Blade Flurry. So if Hoi expects like the Blade Flurry here, then he will put a Shredder. He can put the Shredder on the board just to have a resilient minion against the Blade Flurry.
All right.
It is fine to go for that Druid of the Claw in charge mode and then follow it up with a Shredder here. It puts down Ignite to 16, and then. Yeah, although you're actually. Yeah, I guess you're right, because he has the combo, the cheaper combo, so he has enough mana for Hero Power to represent 15 damage. I guess this play is fine too.
Yeah, he was probably.
That is actually a.
I was trying to say this. I was like, hey, what's more likely? Like, him healing up or him having removal for what comes out of the Shredder? It turns out he has both.
Yeah, this is quite the pickup right there, I would say.
Huh. But he can't play Spell Power and the Healbot with a Flurry.
That is true, but we might just see a Healbot into Eviscerate and then just attack the...
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. They don't have to Flurry yet. You're correct.
Exactly.
Okay, so Ignite hanging on here. And no form of direct damage next to that combo there just yet. It's so surprising to me that he keeps punching the face there.
Oh, really? Oh, again?
Yeah. Wild Growth getting cycled by Hoi. Anyone remember the great play by Ignite in the previous Seed Story Cup? You remember that one? The circle?
Yeah.
Oh, man. That was painful.
I mean, Ignite learned his lesson. He just doesn't bring Priest anymore.
Yeah. Did anyone bring Priest? I'm sure somebody
did. Yeah, some people brought Priest. Purple, I think, brought Priest, for example.
Yeah, I think so too. So this is going to get flurried this time around. Or should get, at least. He's going to Drake first. Oh, wow.
Oh, wow, indeed.
like you backstab, right? I'm thinking if there's way you don't.
For sure. You definitely backstab this.
It's so awkward if you get... No, it's still worth it. Like, even if there's like a Noyotron popping out or something, or like some sort of taunt, even then I think it's correct, right? Just because you're like dodging the damage. Actually, you know what? A sparring partner out of the Shredder would be so awkward off the backstab.
Oh, now he's going for the... Okay, he preserves the backstab, which is fine too.
Alright.
Yeah, it is fine. Ignite doesn't expect his Drake to die, and then backstab will represent another good 3 damage that he can put on a minion, but I don't know.
So
I kind of would have liked to see the backstab here. There's not many minions that Druid can still put on the board that would just be vulnerable to backstab.
So how BM is it to like charge your Druid of the Claw and keep her face? is that like too rude?
I mean, the healing is gone, right?
Yeah.
So Hoi doesn't have to be worried about that anymore.
No, he might be like the, he might the only be thing scared of dying.
Yeah, the only yeah, that's exactly the only thing that Hoi might be worried about if there's like some sick damage with Tinker's Chopsword Oil.
Oh wow, okay. So this actually keeps him alive for one more turn, right? Yeah, because he's not taking more than 2 off of the keeper, so. Oh, he doesn't even have to take any damage. Jesus Christ, man. Do you like the sprint here instead of playing the Shredder on the board as well?
Eventually, he will have to play it, right? So he chose to go for it right now.
I you know what? I really dislike the play for the following reason. Like, what are you hoping? How are you? You have to win this game, right? So how are you winning the game? You need the Shredder on board to get enough damage. Like, you're thinking about combo of your opponent. So basically, how are you winning the game in the next two turns
now? See, here's the thing. He needs those cards, basically. He needs this Thinker Chopsword Oil especially to be able to push through a lot of damage. And you definitely go for the backstep SI that turn. Yeah. And then what do you do with your remaining 7 mana? Would you rather go for the 7 mana card or the 4 mana card?
Yeah, you're right. It just feels off in the way that, like, how do you win?
Yeah, you win with the cards that you draw off of that sprint.
Okay.
That's how you do it. So, yeah, right now, Hoist still might be worried about dying, but eventually he will just have to push the button on the all-in.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see why he wouldn't go for it right now, because as we saw before, the healbot is gone. Why would he be worried about taunt or anything like that?
Yeah, it seems so weird, right? It's like,
maybe he's worried about Lothep or something like that?
Yeah, maybe.
Like, he considers, like, not going all in because there would be, like, a Lothep waiting to completely negate the combo and give Ignite enough time to push through for lethal.
So weird. Another prep sprint coming out if he does want to go for it. Like, is he prepping the sprint or the oil? Probably the sprint, right? How many cards does he have left? Oh, wow, 6 cards. Okay, 9 for Hoi, 6 for Ignite. The backstep does allow for a pretty nice clear onto this if he wants to go for it. That would allow the Shredder to come out as well.
He could also just sap it.
Yeah, he could.
Yeah, I mean, the sap, what is the Ancient of Lore really going to do?
Very true. This is more damage as well. I think that's actually, like, the main factor, right?
Exactly. And this will also allows Ignite to just put all the minions on the board, apply a lot of pressure. Right now, 10 damage to the face. And see, this is the...
Jesus
Hoi,
Christ.
Hoi just gave Ignite too much time. He didn't push the button on the all-in.
But it's
and now Hoi has to go
lethal?
For the board clear.
No, it's lethal.
Oh, wait.
He can play
right.
The second Savage Roar.
I forgot about that. Okay.
Man. Look at Ignite. He's like, God damn it. I got memed.
Sap these casters.
Sap casters.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
Oh, man. That hurts.
Maybe that was what Hoi was going for all along.
Yeah.
Wait. I mean, what?
I don't know what's going on here. Oh, he's going to the bathroom. Okay.
Yeah. So a short bathroom break for Ignite. I mean, I probably will need one myself soon. You'll see.
The beers. How are you liking Seed Story so far, man? Having a good time?
Of course. I mean, there's free booze.
There's free booze. It's always good.
There's free booze. There's Overwatch that I can play. There's people I can hang out with. Free food. Free drinks.
Free fun. Overall
free
awesome.
Fun. Exactly. Like every time.
Like
and,
every time.
And the new location is so sick. There's
it
so
is,
much stuff
it?
You can do. There's an arcade machine. There's... like a DDR arcade machine, there's foosball, there's ping pong, there's pretty much everything you want.
The fun thing is actually, like, people have walked through the location and seen everything, right? There's still a roof on top.
Oh, wow, really?
Yes, that also, like, belongs to the building, right? We also own it. And it's, like, as long as basically this whole area downstairs. So we're actually planning to do something with that. We just don't know what yet. There's so many, like, weird plans for that, like swimming pool shenanigans or, like, a paintball field or whatever, right?
No, that would be so sick. Laser attack or paintball. I want that.
That'd be, like, super... Like, it was actually an idea. Like, we're actually... Like, it was actually considered.
Just do it.
Just do it.
Just...
Well, if somebody pays for it... Directly. No, but, like, we're actually thinking of doing something like that.
So, guys, keep in mind, support Take TV...
For sure.
Disable your ad block, subscribe, become a Take TV Ultra, all that good stuff. Support this awesome channel and support this awesome organization, which is Take TV, bringing you those awesome events like Seed Story Cup.
Yeah, like, we actually do appreciate the support. Like, getting these events down is harder than it looks like because our team is, like, really small. So we stay up day and night just to make this happen. Shout out to the production crew as well. Like, for example, the producer right now is one of our interns, or original interns. She's not an intern anymore, but, like, she does this production, like, 13 hours a day, 4 days in a row. Like, she sits in a room and does production. Like, it's actually, like, it's ridiculous. So,
yeah.
Yeah, a lot of stuff going on. So, it's for your entertainment. You better enjoy. And Ignite just came back, actually, from his bathroom break, so we're going to resume play here.
And what do you think Ignite is going to take here? I mean, he just got... he of course has to pick a deck that's going to be good against Hoist Druid. So we have Ignite's Paladin and Ignite's Druid still remaining. I would suggest, of course, Paladin to be picked, right?
Yeah, I think so too.
Oh, look at this. Ignite actually going for Druid.
Wow, yeah, for real. Okay. Well, his hand isn't too bad. Wow, yeah, that's something to talk about. This hand's actually ridiculous.
This is actually fairly interesting because, in my opinion, against the standard mid-range druid, Paladin, like both versions of Paladin, mid-range Paladin and as well as Secret Paladin, are just super good.
I feel like anybody so would agree with this, by the way.
Maybe he wants to preserve the Paladin for later.
I guess, right? But like, what are you preserving it for?
Well, Hoist Mage, I guess. What? I don't know what mage he played, though.
Yeah, me neither, but I think it's... I mean, it has to be tempo, right? Because why would you keep your... Like, otherwise you would probably keep your druid instead of your secret paladin for, like, freeze mage, right?
Yeah.
So this is probably... Yeah, I think it's a tempo mage, so... I don't know. Maybe he just feels confident with this. He's like, oh, I'm going to sweep with it anyways. Let's win.
All right, we will see.
All right. It's a pretty good starting hand, though.
Yeah, I guess... I suppose he knows how he's playing a tempo mage, so he picks the druid, so he doesn't have to... run the risk of Paladin getting wrecked by Hoist Druid, because then Ignite would be in a more difficult spot.
Yeah, that's true. So, not the worst, or pretty good starting hand for Ignite, but I mean, Aspirant coming down for Hoi is also really sick, and it doesn't get dealt with, so Shredder on 4 coming down for free here. Probably the same for Ignite, though, unless like he decides to like deal with this somehow. We'll see. All right, Shredder coming down. And the trade. Trade's like decent. Swipe could take care of this. You like the swipe?
Yeah, of course. Why not?
All right. Let's do
sick.
It. Do you actually take notes during the game?
Sometimes if I'm really try-harding, then yeah. I mean, you want to get every possible edge on your opponent. So, like, if you want to get any possible edge on your opponent, you just write down whatever cards you've used, which cards so you know which cards you have left in your deck. You write down which cards your opponent has used, so you know which cards your opponent might have left in his deck. And also just to write down, to know what his what's in your opponent's deck in general if he plays it again.
Of course. All right, so the Parrot coming out of the Shredder, it's pretty bad. But the Druid with Claw to follow it up, that's pretty decent. And he does have a Belcher to play this turn. I actually don't think that like a Savage Roar is too horrible here. What do you think? Like Savage Roar with an Aspirant, is that a play you can go for here? I mean, next turn is turn 6. Like the only thing you're scared of from the Druid on that turn in terms of like real damage is like, not like damage in its original sense, but like as a good card is like Thorson, right? And other than that, it's kind of removal turn.
Yeah, I feel like the Savage Roar is pretty solid play. I don't know how you follow it up with, though. You could also use the Wild Growth, but I suppose Aspirant is going to be better because it puts the minion on board. At this stage of the game, Wild Growth is not going to get much value, really.
Yeah.
You might as well keep it for an additional card in the late game.
I agree.
So, yeah.
He's going to play the Aspirant first. Doesn't going to get memed by that Weblord. Not Weblord, what is it? The Mana Wraith. How many Weblords have you gotten, like, from like Shredders? Because I always play for Doomsayers. I'm like, okay, I need to play around this Doomsayer, so I'll check Shredder first, and then I'll play my minion, and then it's a Weblord or like a Mana Wraith, and I just get absolutely memed.
Yeah, the rule of thumb is basically you always play the minion first because it's more likely that a Mana Wraith or a Weblord will come out than so it's two minions instead of just the one Doomsayer. So you always play around. So you always have to play the minion first.
That makes sense. So he goes for boom.
More probable.
Over. So boom over lore here. But there is a BGH in hand for Hoi. It's going to come down this turn. Picks up a shade as well with this. Those bombs are pretty nasty though for that shade. So.
Yeah, you gotta clear those boom bots. I would say.
Yeah.
Well, maybe Hoi wants to ignore it. I don't know. Like. Just he could actually just ignore it, I suppose. The odds of the boombot hitting the shade are not that high.
That's
if
true.
if he has three minions on the board.
Ugh.
Oh yeah, that is actually.
That's a dead Belcher.
He might want to just clear the boombot right now, so it's not able to run through the Belcher and clear it. But then again, that's how I really care. After all, hero power can also clear the Belcher.
Does Hoi really care? I mean, he cares in the sense that his hand isn't, like, super strong, right? So he does feel like he needs to preserve his minions a little bit. Okay, so no Shade coming out this turn. He does want this to hit the face. but does kill the Belcher.
Doesn't really matter, since the hero power would have been able to deal with that Belcher anyway.
Yeah, I guess that's true. So Druid of the Claw coming down, and the top deck Innervate is going to be a keeper on the BGH. One of the things about BGH, actually, like specifically against like a Handlock or something, is that, like, sure, you play it for its battle cry, but it actually deals a lot of damage if you don't take care of it. Like, it actually gets some serious trades if you don't take care of
it. Yeah, it has very good 3-drop stats. I mean, 4-2 is pretty standard 3-drop stats.
Yeah. Like, it's such a good card. All right. Belcher off the top. I mean, it seems like you would just drop your two minions here. Like, swipe doesn't really do anything, right?
Yeah, of course. You drop your minions, you don't attack, and then see where the game goes from there.
Yeah.
Not much else to be done. Sure, there's like the option of swiping so you can use hero power, but what? No.
Yeah, that like makes no sense. I mean, you get so many better trades next turn with a swipe enabled.
Yeah.
Like, you're sticking to your board pretty hard with like Shade Shredder. Time waits for no one. Oh, did you see the World Championships, by the way?
Yes, I did.
Did you see Neilio, or what his name was?
No.
That was this guy. He roped every turn. And I'm not saying, like, oh, he roped every turn. He roped every turn, as in literally every turn.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous.
Yeah, I heard about it. I didn't really witness it. I didn't see all of the matches, but... I saw Neilio play in the actual qualifier for BlizzCon, which he won. But I was not impressed with the level of gameplay he provided. So I obviously was not surprised that he didn't make it out of the groups at BlizzCon.
Yeah. It was ridiculous because his line of play was like, he would never play a new card before the rope hit. Like, the moment the rope hit, he would play the card, like, instantly. But not beforehand, but he would always attack before the rope. It was ridiculous. Never play cards
so
before.
Weird.
Yeah, for sure. All right, so how are we filling out this curve? It seems like Sylvanas could come down, but then you're not really getting any good trades here with the swipe. So what are we doing?
We are casting. Just so you know. I mean, I don't know how much you had to drink, but...
I didn't have anything to drink. I guess I had two beers, but like, does that count? I mean,
two beers. I have two beers right here.
There you go. The strats.
Yeah, both. I mean, Hoi obviously taking his fair amount of time. After all, his tournament life is on the line here.
It is, but he's not. Like, he's dead to combo, right?
Yeah, he knows that as well. He's shaking his head like he does not like the situation he's been put into by Ignite. But we see right now there's no combo in hand. Just the force of nature. Just the first part.
Yeah, and he gets a really good trade and a really good curve.
Yeah, that Sylvanas was basically just on the board to represent some way of dealing with those minions.
Yeah.
And it's not how you want to use Sylvanas. Usually you want to get some more value out of it.
Exactly.
Instead of just trading for an Ancient of Lore that drew two cards.
And I mean, that Thorson and the Shredder top deck is just like insult to injury. I mean, that's so strong.
Yeah, Ignite in a very dominating position. But we have to see what Hoi draws off of this Ancient of Lore.
Nothing can play this turn, so just gonna cycle the Wild Growth. Nothing really you can get off of this anymore unless you play some sort of Living Roots. So that's not gonna happen. So how much damage is this?
The Ignite is digging for that Savage Roar.
Does he
find it?
I mean, he does have 10 from hand, so it's 19 damage he has, right? It's a lot.
Yeah, but not enough yet. Most likely we'll just see a Wrath dig deeper for that Savage Roar.
Yeah, I guess this makes sense, right? Wait for it next turn.
And followed up with Lothep, so Hoi will have a harder time of actually dealing with the board.
Yeah, even more dominant. Because
his only way of dealing with that board immediately is spells.
Yeah. The Ancient Watcher drop sucks, but other than that, you're good. Remember the old Watcher Druid? That was so cool.
Oh yeah, for sure.
That's awesome. It always comes like back once and again, but then it's like only 2 days of like somebody playing it, and then it just dies again.
Someone will always do like this thread. Hey, I just reached legend with this. Insert random deck number XYZ.
You should try it. It's so good. Alright.
You can reach a legend with any kind of deck. All you need to do is play well, and that's it.
Yeah.
And play a lot of games, depending on how good your win rate is with a deck.
Exactly. Oh yeah, this is the B stream, guys.
Yeah, the B stream with the A casters.
Yeah, man. The A grade casters, yeah. For sure.
I mean, if you want to hear some quality casting, you came to the right place.
Exactly.
This
like,
is
screw the mainstream.
And this is Hoi versus Ignite. Definitely a match to watch for.
Screw the mainstream. We're not mainstream.
Yeah, we're having fun here. We're drinking beer. At least I am.
You didn't get me one, man.
You didn't say you want one. It's your fault. If you want something, you have to say it.
That's true.
That's how life works.
That's how life works. And that's going to be game here. Well played, preemptive from Ignite, taking the game.
Yeah, that is how Druid works.
That is how Druid works. Druid things. Deal 10 damage for 6 mana after Thorson. That's how it goes. And that's going to be 2-1 to Ignite, I think.
Oh, the BM swipe. He didn't even need it.
Oh, wow. To the face.
Adding insult to injury.
Insult to injury. And after all, the Druid pick working out over the Paladin.
Yeah, and Ignite definitely in a very good spot here. I mean, mathematically just, right? Because all he has to do is win one game and Hoi has to win two. But
it's always like 60-40 from
with
that
the
perspective, right?
With the Tempo Mage, if it's Tempo Mage. I suppose it's Tempo Mage, yeah. Oh, it's actually Mech Mage even.
Well,
so,
what?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So basically the same thing, just a little bit different in terms of playstyle. But yeah, Mech Mage has been known to just straight up crush druids.
For sure.
Those mid-range druids.
You do need that 6 start, though, as a Mech Mage. Nothing worse than drawing bad.
Yeah, and Oitron is kind of a card that you don't really need.
Yeah.
Might as well just mulligan it the way.
He's definitely keeping the Warper. Oh, Entity is really bad draw. I guess it's like... Yeah, you don't want secrets in hand. That's
in general, you don't want secrets in hand. However, against druid, against a mid-range druid, Entity is pretty sick. The only way to counter it, really, is Danos Desperant. Besides that, you will always get, like, at least a 3-drop or better.
That's true. So, basically, there's just going to be, like, cards removed back and forth in the first couple of turns. Nothing's really going to go down hard. I mean, you're coining the Aspirant here, basically. That's going to get traded. And then you have a Wrath for the Mech Warper, right? Does that seem about right?
Yep, seems about right.
Portals online.
Yeah, that is a pretty sick curve for Hoi.
Yeah.
If that Mech Warper survives. However, we know that there's a Wrath for Ignite and that Fel Reaver will not see play on turn 4.
The thing with the Clockwork Gnome in this position is, sure, it just dies to a hero power, but it blocks the curve, right? Because if you hero power, that's obviously 2 mana lost. So, that sucks so much.
Yeah,
right?
Of course. And you also have to consider that there's a mech on the board, which might trigger a Pyromancer, a Goblin Blastmancer.
Exactly.
Ignite right now could theoretically put something on the board and innervate out the hero power to deal with that thing.
This is actually a very important decision. Like, obviously he doesn't know what he draws, but it's going to impact that so hard, right? Like, if he just draws, like, Thorson or a 5-drop next turn, there's no way he can play it if he innervates now.
Ignite, of course, knows there's a Mirror Entity, but it's fair. It's a fair Mirror Entity because it's not a Mirror Entity out of a Mad Scientist. So it's basically like if Hoi played his own Shade of Naxxramas.
Yeah.
And this is fair.
He is innervating that hero power. Do you think he would have still innervated if he didn't have a Wild Growth in hand? I think that makes a difference, right?
He has the potential of just dropping that Wild Growth. I mean, the Wild Growth will be good on turn 4 or turn 5 even still in order to accelerate into a 7-drop, like an Ancient of Lore or Blocker Boom. And man, that Big Game Hunter in hand, that will be huge.
Yeah, for sure.
This is like the best swing you can have against a Fel Reaver.
We're just like waiting for that because the game kind of resets from there. It's like, okay, Big Game Hunter onto the Fel Reaver after that. Let's see what happens.
But often enough, we see Big Game Hunter is not really that much of a deciding factor. After all, we've seen Hoi in the previous game. Big Game Hunter ready and waiting for the Dr. Boom.
Yeah.
Came down, but still didn't win Hoi the game.
Exactly. Do you want the Mirror Entity to come out of this Wrath, basically? Because, this is so much to think about.
He's gonna cycle, right?
He's gonna cycle, okay.
Yeah.
Do you kill it, though?
I'm fairly sure you do. You don't have any minions right now, so... You might just drop the big game hunter. To just run into the mirror entity with that.
Okay, so he's gonna trade it. And I'd be very surprised to not see the Flower Weaver come down here. I guess it depends on the draw here.
Yeah, this is. I mean, Hoi has no other option here really, and this is gonna be the perfect timing for Ignite. He not only does he kill the Flower Weaver, he also triggers the mirror entity with the best possible minion.
Yeah, and the attack with the Shade is really important as well. Just because, I mean, from the side of Hoi, because you know that your opponent's like going to focus on killing the Reaver, so you do want to get those 8 damage points in.
I'm fairly sure, actually, that the Shades are going to trade against each other. And then, hopefully, Ignite will hope that the Big Game Hunters trade for each other.
Yeah. There's actually an Ancient Lord next turn.
Can we once again see what cards have been removed?
We can. Which card? It's too late, right?
No. It's not too late. There.
Oh, here. Yeah.
Blast Mage and...
Spider Tank, Cogmaster. And then Scientist, Gnome Shredder.
Okay, so no, nothing really relevant besides that one Blast Mage. Like, you always have to call... You always... keep in mind for everyone who's like new to the game, when you play against Fire Reaver, keep in mind which cards have been burned. You have to like remember those high impact cards that really impact the game in a big way. So in this case, it was like one Blast Mage burned.
That's true.
Something like, for example, burn that could finish you off, like Fireball or Frost Bolts. You really have to pay attention to that.
So if the Annoyotron comes down here, do you just like ping? Like, are you trying to be annoying here? As Hoi, like, do you kind of want to force your opponent into some weird plays? Like, I don't know, like, play Annoyotron and, like, ping the BGH, go phase? Yeah, I think so. He's not going to trade. Hello.
Yeah, he wants to push the damage.
Rolling Blade Smork.
I mean, it makes sense because he has those two fireballs in hand. He wants to finish close out the game with that. And he's getting fairly close. But we see with double Ancient of Lore, Ignite will be able to... Actually, heal himself back up and effectively counter those fireballs.
I mean, you have to swipe this turn, obviously. You can't play Ancient of Lore, right?
Yeah, right. I mean, Ancient of Lore. If you play Ancient of Lore here, all you do is negate one attack from the BGH.
Yeah,
and that's not what you want to do in this situation.
Exactly. I mean. The thing that we have to remember is Ignite doesn't know that there's double fireball, right? You see these two cards, and I don't think he's putting him on double fireball. I think he's putting him on at least one good spell, just because the last turn was kind of awkward if he had, like, some big minion.
Yeah, he might expect something like an Antonidas or a Dr. Boom even.
Mm-hmm.
So that is also still a realistic possibility. After all, it's just now turn 7 for Hoi.
Yeah, and Hoi desperately needs a big minion now. Like, he really needs one. Chugger's like, okay, it's a minion after all, but it's not too huge.
Yeah, we see no 7 drop for Hoi. Ignite sees that and he must be happy about that.
Exactly.
So now, and he still sees those two cards not being played. So now Ignite has to know. Like, the alarm bells have to go off that, oh, danger, danger, fireballs incoming.
He has to know, yeah.
Or fireball, frostbolt, something like that.
Something like that. Do you think that'll stop him from, like, drawing cards? Do you think he could, like, heal here?
Yeah, I actually don't see the reason not to do it. You can heal yourself right now. See, and he's actually going for it.
Do you think that's a little too early?
No, it's not, because take a look at this. Fireball, Frostbolt is like 50,
but he only has 8 mana.
Damage. Yeah, right. But still.
Okay.
It represents a lot of damage.
So, since you just drew the Frostbolt, do you just completely YOLO this and just, like, go face already? With everything? Like, don't even clear this Ancient Lore?
Yeah, this is actually a very tough position for the Mech Mage. The problem with Magmage basically is, once that initial board has been dealt with, it's very hard to actually like push forward, refill the board, because there's so little card draw. You have to like put all your faith into that early board that you can put on the board, and then finish off with fireballs and frostbolts. If that plan doesn't work out, then it's a really tough situation. You have to think if you can afford to like keep the fireballs in order to finish the game, or have to use the fireballs to deal with big minions and hopefully let the minions that you draw off the top of your deck be able to seal the deal.
And he's gonna fireball.
Yeah, like how it goes for the board control approach right now.
I think it's fine actually, or right actually, because you're too far away from bursting out your opponent with the cards you have.
Wow, oh, Dr. God. Boom. The perfect pickup, and Hoi does not like the looks of that.
Jesus Christ. I mean, let's keep in mind, if Hoi loses this, he's out.
He's out of the tournament.
He's out. This is loser's match.
One of the best players in the world.
Exactly. Like, he's ranked 3 on Gosu Gamers right now, I think. And Ignite's just like, yeah, you know, up to 1 chilling. The Druid pulling through. So far, at least.
Yeah.
I mean,
this is a really tough situation for Hoi.
Yeah.
What do you do here? Like fireball and oh man, he can't even go for fireball hero power to clear the boom and then like play a shredder because he doesn't have enough mana for it.
Yeah. Face.
So I suppose he's just going to go for hero power the boom bot, and then. Maybe go for like Shredder Frostbolt. No, actually he doesn't. Maybe he doesn't even Frostbolt the Dr. Boom.
Yeah. I mean, he can keep these two alive, right? He doesn't die to combo just yet. He's still going to Frostbolt it.
Okay, he's going to Frostbolt it because he is probably afraid of the Force of Nature combo.
Okay.
Would it represent lethal? 14 plus.
No, it wouldn't.
14 plus 12. That's 26. That's 2 off.
Yeah, it's actually two less because his hero's frozen.
Oh yeah, that too. Yeah, you're right.
Let's see.
But still, like he wants the Shredder to be able to deal with that Dr. Boom.
Okay, not the best bomb. It hits the right target, but not enough damage. So he's thinking of whether or not he wants to go for the lore. I mean, basically, like it's fine to take your time here as Ignite because you're ahead, right? You're so far ahead.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, okay, so how do I keep my opponent from winning this? If I win this, I go to deciders. I just need to win this little game. I'm so far ahead. How do I like limit the chances of my opponent to get
exactly
anything?
What is the best way to throw the game, and how do I not do it?
Yeah, right? That's actually a good approach to it, right?
Yeah,
like
yeah.
Thinking of it.
What would the worst thing be that I could do here? Let's not do that. Let's just do anything else.
That's actually cool. Oh, that's a little late.
Yeah, Tony.
Tony off.
Tony
the
late to the party.
Tony late to the party. Sounds like a college movie. So you definitely like trade your Shredder first, right? Does it block any plays? I don't think so.
I think I have the same mindset as Hoi right now. Just just sigh of disbelief.
So let's say he gets an Annoyotron off of this, and you just play Tony afterwards. That's decent, right?
Best pickup would be Sorcerer's Apprentice, actually, because it would give you a fireball.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Like, Sorcerer's Apprentice making that fireball cheaper would be, like, the best drop-off of the Shredder.
Yeah.
But, yeah, obviously, Hoi does not get that. Gets some Metzitis, which would be good, but both mirror entities are gone already.
Actually, wait, if he got a Pint-sized Summoner off of that, would that have been the same?
Oh, yeah, that would basically be the same thing. Pint-sized Summoner or Sorcerer's Apprentice.
That's funny. Yeah, I like playing Tony.
Right. Yeah, but, you see, it's gonna be dealt with. No big deal.
Swipe buff the top as well. He could actually trade and spell power swipe the face if he wanted to.
Yeah, but double keeper seems to be more valuable, I would say.
The only reason to go with the spell power swipe play is if that would represent lethal next turn with combo on the Drake, but I don't think it does. No, it doesn't. Okay, yeah, so that's not good. Or not correct, rather.
Just double keeper that board. Seems like the most valuable play.
Yeah.
I mean, what are you really going to silence in that matchup anyway? There's nothing. You just use it for damage now.
True. Gonna moonfire that scientist last. This still isn't lethal next turn, but it's still a horrible position here for Hoi. Like, this is the point where you just concede on ladder.
Yeah, that is basically... Yeah, that is true. That is the point. Of course, Hoi will take any chance he can get to maybe stay in this game. Maybe he will hope for a disconnect by Ignite. Yeah. Who knows?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of sad for Hoi because like he came here as a like last minute replacement.
Yeah, that's true. He actually who did he replace?
Let me think. Either Tides or Reynad. Like who?
Yeah,
probably
Tides of Time. Yeah. Froden replaced Reynad and
Hoi
replaced Tides of Time. Fire Bullet Keeper, the worst feeling in the world.
Pretty much.
And Ignite has to be happy about that. He knows. He's got the game in the bag.
He's got this. He knows.
It all basically came down to that big game hunt on the Fel River. This is such a devastating swing. It doesn't impact the game like it doesn't win you the game immediately, but off the back of this huge tempo swing, it just in so a matchup like this, it's usually over after that.
So much more damage. He goes for this trade. And I guess he did the math on this.
Dr. Boom.
It's so late, though.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Wait, how much damage is this? 6, 5, 11. Wait, it's not lethal with combo yet, right?
No, it's not.
Okay.
He's still in it. But yeah, of course. I mean, just...
Yeah.
Swipe. He has the perfect way of dealing with it. Just attack into it. Swipe that thing.
The top decks are just teasing us at this point.
Might as well charge this druid.
Yeah, for sure.
Since there's like, what is there? What's left? Like one frostbolt, maybe.
Yeah, I don't think he plays another flame cannon. All right, so that's gonna be it for Hoi and his tournament life. Feels bad for him, man. But Ignite is going to get another chance to move out of these groups.
Yeah, he's gonna face Ryzen in the next match, right?
Exactly. They actually faced off in the first match of the group as well. They already played against each other, so they know exactly how the other person plays. They're going to be facing each other again.
Yeah.
The handshake. Some warm words coming out of both. And yeah, it's going to be it.
That's it, guys.
That's it. So yeah, we're going to see Ryzen versus Ignite. After a short break, guys, don't go anywhere to see some more content. I don't know if we'll be here or like some new casters. We'll find that out in just a second. But yeah, stay tuned and enjoy.